Now, we are recording. So, as I said, we are starting with the Middle Ages today, and we're going to look at it through the lens of music. So we're going to skip over some of the basic stuff. The bottom of the PowerPoint here, though, we do have to kind of understand a little bit of the social context of where music is coming from and what's driving the music during this time period. So in the Middle Ages covers from 450 AD to 1450 AD. That's 1,000 years of music history in one short section of the book. And again, that's because we just don't have a whole lot of information. There's not a lot of stuff that still exists to show us exactly what was going on there. So that's why this is a shorter chapter of the book, but there was a lot of stuff happening musically in the world. There were a lot of developments as music first started taking shape early on. And again, we are looking at European history because most of the music that we listen to traces back to European music from Europe. So this is kind of through that lens there too. All right, so in Europe during that time period, you had three basic class distinctions that are going on. You have the nobility, which are the richest, the people that rule the land. These are your dukes and your kings. And there's a bunch of these. We have all these small little kingdoms all over scattered throughout Europe. There's a lot of upheaval and war going on between territories, and we're still kind of settling down these areas that are eventually going to become the countries that we now know as Europe. So the nobility during this time period were really sheltered off from the rest of society. They lived in fortified castles, as it says here. They basically lived off of the backs of the peasants. They collected taxes from them, which usually took the form of food. If you had peasants that were in your kingdom, they were growing food and cultivating animals, and the nobility, the knights, would go around and say, okay, you owe us, because we allow you to live in our kingdom, you owe us, you know, one cow or whatever, and a certain amount of grain and things like that, and they would take it, and that's what the nobility lived off of. They didn't generally do the work themselves. They were basically just ruling the kingdom, and most of them were not kind leaders. It was not like they were benevolent and were helping their peasants to have better lives. They were basically using the peasants as slaves and giving them very little. So the nobility were generally not educated during this time because they didn't have to be. All they had to have, they had to be rich, they had to have power, and most of the time that was passed down through genealogy. So we had the nobilities, and then we also had the peasants during this time. And these are the people that lived under the nobility. These were the people that were actually doing the work. This was the vast majority of the population. There were a lot of peasants in every kingdom. And they were the ones that kind of lived your everyday life. People like you and me would have been peasants during this time. Okay. These were the people that were basically subjugated by the feudal overlords. Hopefully in your history classes, you've learned about the feudalist classes and how all of that stuff worked. So you had the peasants there, and of course they weren't educated. They weren't doing any kind of music at all because they didn't have time for it. And then we had the clergy, which was the church. And in this time period, this 1,000 years of European history, the Roman Catholic Church had the most power in Europe. They even had power over the nobility. They had cardinals and priests that would work in the castles with the nobility. And a lot of times they were the ones that were really the powers during this time. The church during this time is known to have been very corrupt. It was a lot of power grabbing. They were basically suppressing the rest of the population. But it was in the church that we see education. The monks, as it says in the textbook, had a virtual monopoly on learning. They were the only people that were learning how to read. They were the only people that were writing. And subsequently, they were the only people that were creating music. And that's where we get to at the beginning of this course. In the Middle Ages, especially early in the Middle Ages, most of the musicians during this time were the priests. They were, music was coming out of the church. All right. And the church, and these were monks in the monasteries that were providing the music. And these church officials had choirs, and they expected, they were hardcore choir directors. They expected, as it says here, the monks to sing with proper pronunciation, with good tone quality, with vigor, with concentration. We even had people like Bernard of Clairvaux, who wanted his monks to sing vigorously and with manliness and a lot of manly emotion there. They were very big on presenting it in a very powerful way, because that showed that you were dedicated to God and dedicated to Jesus if you were singing with vigor and all of that stuff. So they were, we had a lot of great choir directors during that time that were really pushing this singing to be as good as possible. All right. And eventually that starts to make its way out of the church as well. We'll talk about it in just a few minutes. There were very few instruments in church during this time. And that was because of the earlier role in pagan rites. The instruments had mostly been pagan early on, and we do see that that moves into the secular side of music during this time as well, that a lot of those early pagan instruments make their way into secular music, which we'll talk about here in just a few minutes. But even the organ, which we consider to be a church instrument, right, there were a lot of clergy early on that did not like the organ because they felt like it distracted the listeners from the actual worship. If you were listening to the organ play, you weren't focused as much on your own singing and your own praising during that time. All right. What we do know about instruments in church is mostly taken from paintings. There are a few paintings and a few accounts that were written down of people talking about instruments. But again, it was very few and far between in the church during that time. The music was primarily what we now know as Gregorian chant. All right, Gregorian chant was the official music of the Roman Catholic Church from about 14, or about, you know, as early as we can count. It was really established in the 5th and 6th century, and that lasted all the way up into the 1960s. It wasn't until the Second Vatican Council in the mid-1960s that Gregorian chant was deemed no longer the official music of the Roman Catholic Church. Now, there are still a lot of Catholic churches that use Gregorian chant or use parts of Gregorian chant in their worship services, but there is other music there as well. In the Second Vatican Council, one of the things that they ruled is that the music should be sung in the native language of wherever the church was. Up until the 1960s, Gregorian chant is always Latin. It's always in Latin text. And even up until the 1960s, if you were in an American Catholic church, you were still singing in Latin. And there are a lot of churches that still push that. They still use the Latin text in a lot of their music, but it is now officially recognized that you can use other languages as well. And one of the big things about Gregorian chant was that the idea was that if you were singing Gregorian chant, you were singing from the voice of the entire church. It was not from the individual. It was not from you personally, at least early on. We did start to see some Gregorian chant moving away from that later on, but it was generally considered to be the voice of the church as a whole rather than the church, rather than an individual. Because of that, very few Gregorian chants that we have today have authors. We don't know who composed them. Most of them are anonymous. Some of the ones in your textbook are anonymous. We do have very few that actually are attributed to specific composers, and we're going to look at one of those specifically here in just a minute. Gregorian chant is largely monophonic. We touched briefly on monophony last week. Of course, you guys, if you watched the video lecture that I posted because y'all didn't have class on Wednesday, monophonic texture means that there is just one single unison line moving. OK, Okay, even if there's 50 people singing, they're all singing the same melody. There's no harmony at all. That's what monophonic music is. If you have a single instrument playing by itself, or you have a group of instruments that are all playing the same thing, that is monophonic. And Gregorian chant was largely monophonic. You had one priest that would lead the music, and everybody else was singing the same thing that that priest was, exactly. Okay, so it's a monophonic melody that is set to Latin text. All of the Gregorian chant that we have from the Middle Ages and the Renaissance is set to Latin text. The melodies tended to be very basic. They moved in stepwise motion, and they tended to fall in within a narrow range so that anybody could sing them. You didn't have to be a virtuoso singer to be able to sing these melodies. One of the ones that we're going to look at here in a minute, pretty much all of the music falls between here and here. And because it's mostly men that are singing, it's in here. So it's stuff like... basic melodies within a very narrow range. And it made it easier for the monks to teach it to them. These Gregorian chants do not typically have a sense of rhythm or beat to them. It's not something you're going to tap your foot along to or add a drum beat to. It's very flexible. It just kind of flows. And these monks were learning this music by rote, so they didn't have to have a steady beat to follow because they just memorized what the priest had been doing to teach it to them. Okay, Gregorian chant was named after Pope Gregory the First. That's a test question. You don't. I don't want to spend too much time on that. But Gregory the First basically organized the church liturgy, which just means that he set in motion the idea that a worship service should follow a specific pattern, that you needed to have all of these different parts of the worship service and they needed to go in this order. Some churches still follow that. In fact, a lot of other churches, if they have traditional worship services, Presbyterians, Episcopalians, tend to follow a lot of the similar liturgy that was set in place by Pope Gregory. Okay, if you go to a traditional church that everything kind of moves in the same order, that's a liturgy. And that's what Pope Gregory the First put in place for the Catholic Church. Early on, these Gregorian chants were passed down orally by rote, meaning that one priest would sing it and teach all of the monks that specific melody for that specific tune. Later on, though, they did start writing them down to make it easier for one church to send a chant that somebody had written to another church, so they could write it down and pass it on that way. They use church modes, which you don't have to worry too much about. They're basically predecessors to our modern scales. The earliest surviving manuscripts we have come from about the 9th century. Okay, so let's look at a couple of specific examples here. The first example we have is Alleluia Vinimus Stellum. This is an anonymous Gregorian chant. We don't know the composer of that. And it is monophonic, as I said, and it follows a church mode. And one of the things that you'll notice from this is that there's not very much text to this piece, but there's a lot of notes. So what you'll have is they'll hold a syllable and they'll move for a long time over that one syllable. You'll get, you know, Alleluia. And that's the, they'll move. There's a lot of notes that in one word that they would stretch out. And we'll look at the sheet music for that here before we listen to it. So just to show you an example of the written down Gregorian chant would look similar to this. It really doesn't resemble modern music notation in any way, shape, or form. You can kind of see the up and down movement, and the different shapes might have given them an idea of how long to hold some of these notes. But this early version didn't really tell us a whole lot. And then, of course, this is the Latin text here. Now, this is not Alleluia, Vidimus, Stellum. This is a different example. You also notice that these, the music that was written down, these were works of art. They didn't just write out the plain sheet music like you see today. They were highly ornate. And you had a lot of times you would have a picture that would kind of depict what the music was talking about, whatever the scene was for the music that we heard. Okay, and this is a modern, oh man, that's not what I meant to do. Here we go. This is a modern translation or transcription of Alleluia, Vidimus, Stellum, as well as we can figure out how it would have been sung by the monks back then. There's music historians that have studied the text that we have and read accounts of the music and kind of have a good idea and estimation of what this would have sounded like. And this is what we've come up with. Okay, so as you can see, the word Alleluia goes on for all of these notes. It's just one word. All right, and then the word Vidimus goes all the way to here. So from this repeat sign here at the B section all the way to there is one word. And then Stellum, which means star, is all the way from here to there. So a lot of notes within one syllable. Okay? So we're going to listen to a little bit of this piece. And you can follow along with the text here. It is a very simple text. As you can see, there's not a lot of it. So it's Alleluia, which means hallelujah. And then the verse, we have seen his star in the east and are come with gifts to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. So those three lines of text plus repeating the word hallelujah a couple times goes on for 2 minutes in this Gregorian chant. And this is what it sounds like here. For the sake of time, we're not going to listen to all of these, but when you go and do the listening assignments, you will listen to them. So again, monophonic in texture. We had a large group of men singing this, but they were all singing the same line. All right? And it sounds probably very foreign to your ears. It does not resemble modern music at all, but this is the very earliest trace that we have of where music started for us. Next up, we need to talk about a very important composer of Gregorian chant named Hildegard von Bingen. Hildegard was an abbess of the convent of Rupertsburg, which meant that she was the head monk, basically, or the head nun, I guess she would have been. It's interesting that we have Hildegard of note because there are very few female composers in European music history to begin with, but one of the earliest ones that we know of was a female composer, and that's Hildegard. So Hildegard is around the 12th century is when she lives, and she is composing a large number of works and wrote them down, which is what really is significant here. And her music is Gregorian chant, but it's kind of the first evolution of Gregorian chant. It starts to move in different ways. She expands the range a little bit. She uses a little bit more emotion in her music. And you can read a little bit about Hildegard here. She was very important. That's really basically what we need to know. She was real smart. She was very powerful, and she was very important during this time. So the piece that we're going to listen to is Osyxorus from Hildegard. Again, it is monophonic in texture. But something that's different, that Alleluia Vitam Stellam that we listened to, it seemed to just kind of meander, right? The melody didn't really seem to go anywhere. It didn't have a terribly satisfying flow to it. Hildegard was different. Her music, while it's still monophonic Gregorian chant, it still has a sense of progression. It feels like it moves. It feels like it goes somewhere, and it has a satisfying end to it. And that was something new that we hadn't seen before. All right, it moves gradually, and it has a wider pitch range that we saw. The melody is going to climax on the word officio, which means service. So this piece of music is all about the service of the Lord. And her melody reaches that climax with the word service of the Lord there. And this piece would have been written, of course, for nuns to sing in her abbey. So here's a little bit of this. You can follow along with the text here, and you'll see as we get down to, and hopefully you'll hear, as we get down to in officio agni, the service of the Lamb, will get, you'll hear that climax in the melody happen there. So here's Hildegard's Osyxorus. So what are some things that you notice that set this piece apart from Vitam Stellam that we just listened to? What do you think?
It was actually pretty.
It was pretty?
I mean, that's the best way I can describe it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Hildegard's music is beautiful. And a lot of it has to do with that progression, that sense of emotion that makes its way through the music. Did you guys feel that climax as it got to the end there, talking about the service of the Lamb? Right? What else did you notice? Was this recording purely monophonic? No. There was another there was an instrument in there as well, doing one of those drones that we talked about. That was something that Hildegard was fond of. What's interesting about that is that the sheet music that she had written down did not include those drones in it. We only know that she used those based on literary accounts of it. So she would just instruct a string player to play certain notes that they would then sing over the top of. Okay, good. So a little bit of an evolution, just a small evolution in music over the course of about 500 years, 600 years before we get to this point. So it's a slow moving machine, but we're getting there. So while this stuff is going on in the church, we do have some secular music happening at the same time. And I want to talk a little bit about that real quick. So secular music was primarily composed by troubadours, who were these French nobles that were also poets and musicians. It was very fashionable in France for the nobility to write music and sing. They would also go on adventures. And sometimes they would actually send other troubadours to kind of represent them and go around the country singing these songs. They were written down, but they did not necessarily have a lot of information there. They didn't include rhythms. They just kind of had the melody, and you had to figure it out from there. So these were often performed by these minstrels, these traveling minstrels, which are basically folk musicians that would travel around the countryside, going into taverns and singing these songs. So the song topics, we had songs of love, songs of the Crusades or adventure, dancing songs, and spinning songs that were very common during this time period. If you watched the Witcher series, and you're familiar with, of course, Toss a Coin to Your Witcher, which everybody knows, that is an example of kind of a pseudo troubadour song that was very similar to what you would see here. And if you've ever watched anything set in that time period, that kind of Renaissance or fantasy time period, you get these same ideas. Even the Lord of the Rings trilogy includes some songs that are kind of in the series, in the style of the troubadours, right? They did have instruments. They commonly used instruments in secular music, primarily for dancing. There's a lot of percussion to kind of get this driving beat to that we'll listen to in a little bit. And you've got a few famous troubadours here that we're not going to worry too much about. But I want to listen to a couple of examples. So most troubadour songs were really split into two different styles. You had these slow, pretty love songs, which we're going to listen to from Beatrice here in a second. And then you had these kind of upbeat dance tunes like we're going to hear in the SMP. And they're very different in nature. The love songs, you'll hear some of the influence of that Gregorian chant, the way the melody flows, the way that the song is written. But it does have an instrumental accompaniment with it. So it's actually going to be homophonic in texture, where you have somebody playing a lute or an early guitar, and then the singer is singing over the top of it. And then the SMP is a more is a dance instrumental piece. It's going to have a strict, clear rhythm so that people could dance to it. And it's going to be it's going to be broken down in different ways. You have a melody, which is accompanied by, again, one of those drones that we talked about at the beginning of class, where we have two simultaneous repeated notes playing through the entire thing on an instrument called a psaltery, which is kind of a very primitive guitar. It's just two strings stretched across a stick, basically, and you would pluck the strings to get this kind of drone sound. And then they would sing or play over the top of that. Okay, so let's listen to these two pieces real quick. You do have listening guide pieces or listening assignments that are based on these. So we have an intro to this one that's played by kind of a predecessor to the violin. And again, this would be sung by a female minstrel, basically at a tavern or something, surrounded by people, and she's telling a story here. And it is written in French, as opposed to Latin. And then there's an instrumental thing that ends it. So that's all of the singing. Did you read the lyrics as they were going by? It's kind of a tragic love song, right? This is 12th century T. Swift, right? I love the last two lines especially. "For I am every bit as betrayed and wronged as I deserve if I were unattractive." Basically, he's treating me like trash, treating me like dirt. And it starts off with, "I'm so angry at this guy because I love him very much, but he has, you know, run off with some other woman, or he's treating me as if I'm nothing to him." So, you know, it's a folk love song written in the 12th century. But the melody had that kind of Gregorian chant feel to it, right? But then you add on just that little bit of instrumentation and you get more of a sense of longing there. And you start to really kind of see where music is going at this point. And then we have the estampie. Aiden asked about Skyrim. The music from Skyrim is very much based on medieval and Renaissance music. A lot of fantasy movies and games are going to use that style of music for sure. In fact, one of my students last year told me about a book series called The Name of the Wind that's all about the main hero, the main character is a lute player. So it's very much based on the Renaissance and Middle Ages style. I think the Skyrim music is more similar to what we're going to hear in the Renaissance on Wednesday. Okay, so here's the estampie. This is a short little piece. So again, music for dancing, very simple drone underneath with the melody. All right, in the last 5 minutes here, I want to talk about where music kind of goes, the development of polyphony. We're going to briefly, this book, the brief edition of the textbook, doesn't go into a lot of detail about organum. Basically, between 700 and 900, we start to add a second line to these Gregorian chants, and it creates what we would have as organum, which basically means Gregorian chant with a second melody added to it. And that gets more and more and more complex as we go along. Landon and Perrotin are two of the composers that were really big on this, what's called the School of Notre Dame in Paris, that really pushed this along. Again, our version of the textbook doesn't get too much into them. More importantly, we get into the 14th century, which is kind of our transition into the Renaissance, which we'll cover on Wednesday. And we talk about the Ars Nova, the new art, which is this new idea where music is no longer based on Gregorian chant. We've got these fully polyphonic lines going on. We've developed from Gregorian chant through organum into this new purely polyphonic style. And we have composers that are writing a lot of secular music as well as church music. So it's okay for composers to do both by the time we get to the 14th century. Some of the new music is notated. It's written down. We can start to get an idea of some rhythm written down, and that again comes from Lanon and Paradin. And a great example of this is the music of Landini. This is a piece called Ecco la Primavera, which is again written to accompany a dance. There's a lot of syncopation involved here, and I'm just going to play it from this YouTube video because it's basically the same. So you have two distinct melody lines happening at the same time. And then finally we get to Guillaume de Machaut. Morgan, I'll answer your question in just a second. Who was, again, a composer that wrote primarily love songs with instrumental accompaniment, but then also wrote some other music. And I want to close today with one of his pieces called Puisse qu'on oublie, which is another beautiful love song. And when you do the assignment, you'll listen to the Agnus Dei from him. So just hang tight for a second, if you don't mind. We've got a couple of minutes before class is over. And listen to this Puisse qu'on oublie to close class. So just two or three lines of music happening there, but it adds so much more emotion to it as we go through. And that's where we're going to go into the Renaissance on Wednesday. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be here for another few minutes.